следов. Опять меняю время на песок. If you are one of those people who follow forums and social media on the internet about naval history and naval technology, you will know that one of the subjects that is often discussed is why the Soviet and now Russian designs for aircraft carriers are so inferior to the American designs. Which is actually true if you measure the capability of the design according to the American metrics. In any case, developing countries like India or China are starting in these years their naval aviation journey from Russian-inspired designs. Why are they using those designs as an inspiration? This is the first of a mini-series of two videos discussing the evolution of the Soviet naval aviation doctrine and the long shadows that it is still casting on modern navies today. As usual, stay till the end because this is a story that is not easy to find anywhere else. And if you stay till the end, YouTube will know that this is a good video and it will show it to other people who may be interested. At the end of the Second World War, the minister of the Soviet Navy, the Admiral Nikolai G. Kuznetsov, was well aware of what has happened at sea, even if Soviet operations have been on a very small scale. He was well aware of the preeminence of the aircraft carrier that actually superseded the battleship as the cornerstone of the power at sea. In 1945, while the war was drawing to a close, he proposed a plan for 9 heavy aircraft carriers and 6 light carriers. Stalin and other top echelons of the party were actually not convinced. The shipbuilding industry was recovering from the war, and after all, aircraft carriers didn't seem to be the priority. For a while, Stalin toyed with the idea of building a couple of light aircraft carriers just to acquire some carrier experience, but even that idea was abandoned in the end. Stalin itself defined the Soviet naval strategy by saying, "We are not going to fight at sea by the shores of America." Actually, till Stalin's death, he himself and Kuznetsov periodically revisited the idea, but nothing was ever done. When Khrushchev came to power in 1953, Kuznetsov proposed a carrier building plan as well, but Khrushchev and his defense minister Bulganin were not impressed. Again, they did not believe it was a priority for the Soviet Union. It was becoming increasingly clear that the conflict between the East and the West was going to be mainly a land-based clash. However, this did not mean that there was no naval dimension. Actually, there was a rather important one. A large fraction of the NATO forces and an even larger fraction of the supplies that the NATO required to fight the war was actually stationed in the North American continent. Moving these assets to continental Europe was obviously key to successfully confronting the Soviet and the other Eastern European forces, and obviously this was going to happen by sea. So at the end, the only really relevant mission of the Soviet Navy became disrupting this flow of supplies in the middle of the Atlantic. When Admiral Sergei Gorshkov replaced Kuznetsov in 1956, this mission was made official. Gorshkov declared that with the advent of the anti-ship missile, the American carriers were only large targets. Obviously, this meant it became very difficult for the Soviets to justify any investment in carrier-based aviation. So the Soviet Navy became focused on submarines and anti-ship missiles, either surface-launched or air-launched. It is in this period that the Soviet Union starts building its own naval bomber force. So the plans for building a carrier force went definitely out of the door. Like it happens every time you throw something out of the door, carrier-based naval aviation came back from the window. In the 60s, America's SLBM's menace was becoming real. At the time, the nightmare scenario was a launch with a low trajectory from waters not too far from the Soviet Union, and a tactic that would have left very little time for a reaction. On their side, the Soviets started to operate their ICBM from under the polar ice cap. There they were safe from detection and they would have survived any possible kind of counterforce attack. Since nothing lasts forever, American attack submarines started operating under the polar ice cap to hunt the Soviet ICBMs. So these two new American threats actually prompted for Soviet reaction. The Soviets had to ramp up their anti-submarine capabilities, and one of the new assets for the mission was the Moskva-class helicopter carriers. The two Moskvas were relatively large helicopter carriers with an air wing composed by 14 Kamov 25 helicopters. The ship itself was heavily armed with anti-submarine weapons. And not that helicopters at sea were anything new, but it was the first time that the Soviets were operating a carrier air wing at sea with the purpose of controlling an area of the sea with airborne assets. And when the ships were first identified, Western navies basically freaked out. To be honest, the ships themselves were no more dangerous than other naval assets that the Soviets already had. And actually, they started showing some limitations and problems quite soon. And that probably was natural because they were the first helicopter carriers ever built in the Soviet Union. What concerned the NATO admirals was the fact that they were thinking that the Moskvas and the helicopters were the first step that was going to take to Soviet carrier battle groups. They were concerned because even a limited number of Soviet carrier groups would have severely limited the options of the American carrier groups. Soviet carrier groups meant that rather than just patrolling the Atlantic up and down, making sure that the Soviet Navy of the North and the Baltic was not going to exit and get into the Atlantic, they would have had to fight a proper battle to make the Soviet carrier groups inoperable. These concerns seemed even more justified in 1972 when the first of the Kiev's aircraft carrying cruisers was actually launched. The carrier wing was composed by a dozen of Yak-38 Forgers and about 20 more helicopters. The ship armament in this case seemed to be oriented toward surface-to-air defense like would have been on a Western carrier. However, there was an oddity. In fact, there was a battery of anti-ship missile, and well, everybody thought that after all, the Soviets had their own quirks and twists. The Yak-38 Forger is often considered a mediocre jet, and indeed it was less sophisticated than the Harrier. However, if compared with contemporary versions of the Harrier, it had slightly better performances, and in particular, it had a much longer range in air-to-air configuration. The icing on the cake for the Western commands was the leaked news that the Soviets were working on an 80,000 tons conventional cattle project named Orel. The configuration of the ship was never finalized, but it had to be a nuclear power carrier with an air wing of about 70 combat planes, apparently heavily inspired to the American designs. After the end of the Cold War, in fact, it was ascertained that there was at the time a new current within the top ranks of the Soviet Navy that was pushing for the adoption of carrier battle groups similar to the American models. However, this current was once again sidelined by the then Minister of Defense, Dmitry Ustinov, and under his tenure, the Orel project was actually scrapped. Project Orel had been considered too expensive, too complex, and definitely not aligned with the main mission of the Red Fleet. So the next generation of Soviet carriers was an evolutionary project with a Stobar configuration that was going to become the Ulyanovsk class. In the meanwhile, the NATO admirals were following these developments with increasing concerns. The Soviet capabilities kept improving, and in their mind it was clear that sooner or later they would have to confront with Soviet carrier battle groups that would only have compounded with the assets that the Soviets already had in place. At least this was the unanimous consensus among the analysts, and like it always happens, they were completely wrong. But this is going to be the story of the next video. In fact, in the next video, we are going to answer the question where we started from: why the Soviet and now Russian designs are so popular with the emerging countries. So if you found this video interesting, I'm sure you will find the videos that are going to appear beside me even more interesting. In the meanwhile, please like, dislike, subscribe to the channel and hit the bell so you won't miss any other video. And if you could consider supporting the channel on Patreon or Subscribestar, you will have my gratitude forever. In the meanwhile, thank you very, very much for watching, and see you the next time.